They're heading for Lough Erne's big regatta. They haven't had a day out like this for almost 100 years and they're excited.
It's thrilling to see Crom brought back to life like this. I think it's just lovely.
Seeing the fleet coming towards me and the entire breadth of Trial Bay covered in canvas is a dream come true.
Actually, you know, it's very emotional. To me, growing up, I mean, I seen loads of these pictures hanging in the castle and in albums, and we've never seen it for real.
Oh, I think it's excellent because Crom is such a beautiful estate. It's such a peaceful setting, but it's got such a wonderful heritage.
This is the first regatta since the early 1900s, and the reason the regatta stopped is a tragic story in itself. Here on the Cavan Fermanagh border, the old boats on the water are connected to the windmills in the background like a 3D history lesson. And the phrase that connects the boats with the windmills is Anglo-Irish. You know that back in the 1800s, the Anglo-Irish were the landlords who controlled all they surveyed. They had power enough to make things happen, like moving a parish.
Lord Erne's family had a row or fallen out with the Bishop of Clogher, and the third Earl's wife decided she wanted to build her own church. So she built it across in Derivore, so it meant that it came under the control of the Bishop of Kilmore.
Did the Bishop of Clogher go to her funeral, I wonder?
He probably did, to make sure she was dead.
The local ascendancy here specialised in competing with each other on the water. They took it so seriously that for one race, Lord Erne made his team a remarkable promise.
He promised one of the Goodens, who was his boat-building family at Crom, that if they won the race for him, that he would grant anything they wanted. So the Crom team did win the race in this particular year, and they were all expecting Pat Gooden to ask for something like raised wages or a new cottage or something like that. The Gooden family asked for a local parish priest who was called Father James Clark to be reinstated because he had married a Protestant lady and the Catholic lad, which was against the law in the penal times. And so he had to escape to America. And Lord Erne was able to pull a few strings. And Father Clark came back from America and he was reinstated. And the proof of that is that there is a big plaque in the church.
Year after year at the annual regatta at Crom, the landlords tried to beat each other with better designs and faster crews.
So important was it that even the Kaiser, the German Kaiser, would ask, what's the latest development at Crom?
This boat was built in 1908.
Oh, they're just beautiful to sail. They just glide through the water. Lovely. Gentle, fresh. Just a lovely lady.
Well, it was incredibly special. I mean, the family really only came to Crom during the summer months to sail. I mean, it was the hub of the social scene, and people would come from all over the world, United Kingdom, to stay with the family. And we had two particular other families that we sailed against incredibly competitively, which was the Sarnesons and, of course, the Massey Beresfords. There was a lot of rivalry going on between the three families, but they would give each other the most extravagant and upmarket prizes, such as silver cups and silver plates, etc.
Steamboats, for me, are the icing on the cake, because they were like the ribs. They were the powerboats of the Victorian and Edwardian days. They were the boats that would take you to and from your yacht, you see.
Basically, I get up in the morning and clean all the stanchions and the brass. Sometimes I put it in steam for Len if he's a bit busy or he's off talking. I light the fire and get it going for him. And they say women can talk, but I think he talks more than I do.
There's more on the annual regatta at Crom on the RTE radio website. Go to the documentary on one page. However, although it's called the annual regatta at Crom, it hasn't been annual for almost 100 years.
When I came here in 1987, when I was doing work for the National Trust here, there were stacks of boats, canoes, all the way up here, clinker boats. And it was sort of a sad sight, I felt, because they had all been stacked up in 1913, ready for the 1914 season. And here they all still were, sitting here in the yacht house, waiting for a season that never came, because all around the lock during the Great War, 1914 to 1918, all the families lost sons, and a whole generation was wiped out. It was the end of an era.
With the outbreak of World War I in 1914, a lot of the family members and those that we sailed against would have gone off to war. It could have been uncles, you know, sons, nephews, etc. Sadly, as we all know, a lot of people didn't come back from the First World War. And I think that was the beginning of the end of, you know, the good house, weekend, family, summer tradition.
The Great War didn't cut the Anglo-Irish ascendancy in its prime. By then, many landlords were already living on loans and government bailouts.
It was a very pronounced end to a social era that was coming to an end anyway. The First World War, the Great War, was a coup de grace for the ascendancy in Ireland and very much for the ascendancy around Lough Erne, absolutely.
And the area around Lough Erne still has lessons. For example, those windmills. They belong to the Sean Quinn Group. The same wind that drives the boats of the old Anglo-Irish era turns the windmills of the new Anglo-Irish era. The regatta is a great day out, but no one's kidding themselves about the Anglo-Irish economic empire that it commemorates.
It isn't possible for families like ours to keep a place like this anymore. We move on.